Hi, and welcome to Ask GMBN Tech, the weekly Q&A session. If you've got any questions about mountain bike tech, be that new or old stuff, get involved in the comments underneath. Use the hashtag AskGMBNTech, and also, do subscribe to the channel. We put out free content every week. If you don't, please subscribe, support us, hit that notification bell as well, so you'll see every time we have a video popping up. First question this week is from Soren Gade. I've got SRAM Access, the GX model, and I want to replace the jockey wheels. I've found a 14/16 tooth size. Will they fit? And what are the advantages or disadvantages of changing jockey wheel size? Okay, so I've not tried fitting the bigger 16 tooth. So normally I think it's a 14 is the bigger of the two in there. So as far as I know, they will fit most GX, X01 and XX1 derailleurs. I'm sure there might be some exceptions, but generally from what I know about online, they will fit. Now the advantages of having the bigger wheels are your chain wrap. So the way the chain moves at a less acute angle, there's less friction in the chain moving, which is always a good thing. So you might have seen some people running those huge ceramic speed pulley wheels, which are very expensive, but they unbelievably fast how they work, and they certainly save a lot of watts from your power from the cranks going through that transmission. How much difference that actually makes in terms of mountain biking when you're riding on mixed surfaces, I'm not sure. If I'm completely honest, I've never really tried it because you've got tire pressure, you've got the surface you're riding on, it could be hard dirt or it could be soft grass. There's a number of other things, but I guess reducing friction in any way possible, it's got to be a good thing. The downside might be a bit of clearance in your system. You won't know until you try it, but I have heard that they do work on there. So there you go. Has anyone out there used anything like the ceramic speed bearings that you can get for the pulley wheels, or in fact, their own brand pulley wheels? I have considered trying to make a video on the most friction-free bike. So I do remember a lot of World Cup racers like Steve Peat, his mechanic Andy Kiffin used to remove things like the seal from the freewheel body on the hub. You know, any seals basically to bearings that basically can slow things down. So you might think that's nominal, but in a sport one on hundredths of tenths of seconds could be a winning margin. So maybe it's going a little bit far like our road riding friends, but all interesting stuff, I think. Next from Conrad, who asks, is there any advantage from switching between 35 and 31.8mm bars? Okay, so there's two things at hand here. So aesthetics and then the ride feel. So aesthetically, I personally prefer the slimmer 31.8 on everything except perhaps e-bikes or downhill bikes or particular frames that have like a larger, chunkier front end, in which case the 35mm just suits them a bit better. And ultimately, I think that is really the thing that has led them in the industry is how they look on the front of a bike, especially if you have a high-rise bar. If you've got a particularly high-rise bar in a 31.8, it can look a little ugly, but you slim it down, you slim down the rise effectively, visually, by having it in the bigger bar. It makes it look neater, but you still get the benefit of the rise. Now, the way they feel, however, is totally different between different brands and different materials, like the aluminium options out there and the carbon ones. Now, I've ridden some, have been so stiff, it's, for me, almost painful. There's nowhere for the flex to go and you're feeling all that buzz, but some people will love that direct feel. So I do think it is a personal preference, and it's not always the case. I've ridden some bars in 35mm that I've been, you know, like as I say, barely able to ride, and then gone to the 31.8, and they felt fine. Whereas I've got on one of my bikes over there, I've got a set of nuke-proof bars. In fact, my hardtail, the nuke-proof Scout that you can see in this photo here, it's got 35mm bar on it. And I've also got the same rise bar, which I think is a 38mm rise bar, in the 31.8. And to me, I've not noticed any difference in this brand. Some brands though, there is a significant difference. So I'm interested to know if what I'm saying rings true with anyone watching this show actually. So if you've got any comments along these lines, let us know down there about the 31.8 and the 35mm bars. Do you find them too flexy, too stiff, look repulsive, look lovely? Let us know in those comments. Hopefully that helps you out there, Conrad. Next one is from Jesper. Hi, Doddy and Anna. Do you think putting a 29-inch front wheel on my 27.5-inch hardtail is a good idea? Will it turn into a shred machine or will the geometry be ruined? Is it a good idea? Nah, it's not a good idea, mate. I wouldn't bother doing that. Your bike is designed for 27.5-inch wheels. If your bike has 29-inch wheels front and rear, it's kind of different putting a smaller rear wheel on. There are more benefits to be had from doing that than putting a bigger front wheel on a bike designed for small wheels. So clearance won't be quite as good. If it's a I mean, you say a hardtail, you haven't said what style of hardtail or even the size. For argument's sake, let's say your hardtail has fairly conventional geometry, which means by adding a bigger front wheel, it's going to be closer to where your feet are on the pedals. Now, mountain bikes don't generally have the problems of toe overlap that you get on road bikes, but it can still be an issue. And it would just upset your handling, to be honest. If you want your bike to feel a bit slacker and a bit more aggressive, the cheapest and quickest way to do it is a bigger front tyre. So if you've got 2.4, get a 2.6 on there. You'll slacken it out, you'll bump up the front end, it'll go over bumps that bit better, and hey, might look a bit cooler as well. Next one from Bovana. I cased a 2 meter gap at the weekend and bottomed my rear shock out. Now when I sit on my bike, the rear shock bottoms out straight away. Is my shock blown? Well, sounds like it, to be fair. So there's a few things that can happen here. It doesn't sound like your air spring or anything like that is blown, because you would have said that it's just down the whole time. So if there's a lack of resistance in supporting the shock, there's a good chance you've blown some seals there in your damper, which basically has oil pushing past pistons and shims. Yeah, so if you put so much force through it, it is possible to blow a seal, oil leaks out, and then the damper offers no support. If that's the case, it's not the end of the world, it just means a service on your rear shock. Telltale signs will be some oil leaking out somewhere, or perhaps a collection of dust or dirt that's stuck on the shock, or perhaps on the frame in that area. So have a little look up close and you might see that's the case. Best protocol is to contact your local bike shop or your nearest suspension service centre. In the UK, that might be someone like Ride Fox UK or TF Tuned or Full Factory Suspension or Sprung. Overseas, there's various different options. Anyone that's got a real core suspension tuner, I've asked this before, in different countries, Europe and America and stuff, please feel free to give them a shout out down there, because they're all brilliant people that offer brilliant services to help people like you out. Next up, hi Doddy. How often should we change aluminium bars? Ooh, this is a good one. Is it just a myth that need to be replaced even if you don't crash? Okay, I can't give you a defined answer here. Now, this is something I think I should go to like a material specialist over. There will be different fatigue lives on the different types of material, like 7071 aluminium versus 6061 or whatever. They can have slightly different fatigue lives on them. So I have heard brands recommend that after 3 years of riding, you should consider replacing bars, but no one says it in firm writing. Now, with an aluminium bar, for example, I would say it's fairly safe. You can inspect your bar visually. If you take off your clamps, you know, so your brake levers, your dropper post remote, all that stuff, even take the bars off the bike, inspect them. Use your common sense. If they've got scoring marks on them from maybe over-tightening clamps, that will create a stress rising point. That will be a weak area at the bar. And that is just, if you look at where people break bars, it tends to happen where clamps or curves are on the bars. They will be your weak points. Sense check as well. If you've had a massive crash and your bike's gone cartwheeling down a hill, personally, I would be inclined to replace the bars. It's up to you. You know, I can't give you a firm guide on this, but I will ask some people because there are fatigue lives, and I know the guys in GCN have this sort of stuff a lot more because their stuff's, well, quite frankly, astonishingly light, and of course, because of that, you're going to get damaged and be more susceptible to it. A prime example is drop handlebars. Where they're covered up in the bar tape, you don't see the problems, but one of the classic ones you get on road bikes, especially if the rider is an extremely hardcore rider, is you get salt. Salt drips off you when you're sweating and you basically get salt crust on the handlebars, and the salt can actually rot those handlebars. I've seen bars snap and perish from basically the rotting from salt on them. It might sound excessive amount of sweat to get there, but those roadies ride flipping hard, I tell you, especially if you're an indoor trainer. So one of the guys that used to work for Ride Fox UK, I think he's still there, a guy called Tim, he had a trainer bike out the back, and that bike was almost rotten with just the sweat that would just absolutely disintegrate the bike. You think salt is not a particularly good thing to be anywhere near a bike. So it would pay you every now and then just to check things there. But I will speak to someone, a very specialist on this, to actually see if there is a defined bit of advice we can give, because to be fair, I can't give that. But use your common sense. If you've been using them a long time, you might want to consider replacing them. Next up, I know the common axle for today is a through axle, but for those of us who are running more budget bikes, what's the best 9mm quick release axle to buy? Is there a stronger material I can look at? So by the axle, I'm assuming you're not meaning the actual quick release skewer, because the skewer that goes through, that's not supportive. That is literally just to tie it together on the bike. The actual axle, which is hollow and which is a 9mm axle, to be honest, the only way you're going to get a much stronger version would be to go for a solid one. So therefore, you won't be using a quick release and you'll have screw and bolts, so screw and nuts on the end to hold it in place. That is the strongest way of going down that route. Most bike shops will be able to sort you something out. It's an old cup and cone style system with a 135mm axle. And if your bike is a quick release 9mm like that, then it's probably compatible with those sort of kits. They should be available for many hubs out there. That's probably your best option, I would say, if strength is your outright concern there. They are heavy though, that's the downside, but they're definitely going to be stronger. Next up from Super JRoT, my XTR brake is acting up. Sometimes when I grab the brake, the lever gets hard early, other times it's kind of spongy. Okay, telltale sign of airing. When I immediately let go and grab it right away, it gets fine. So that's pumping up the brake. So some people might be familiar with, you feel the brake and it goes almost to the bar. Do it a couple of times and then it feels okay. Telltale sign you have air in your system there. It says, I've done a couple of oil bleeds and changed the O-rings on the calipers, but still does it. What can I do about it? Okay, so you have got trapped air in there. So a full bleed is necessary. And sometimes leaving the system open will help you. Now, because you've got a Shimano system, you've got the ability to do this. Now, with the Shimano system, they run mineral oil on the inside. Now, mineral oil is not susceptible to ingesting air into the actual fluid. So therefore, you can do this safely without compromising that fluid. If your brake has dot fluid, for example, you should keep it sealed, really. And when it's open, technically, you should replace it. But, you know, there's no written rule on how fast you should replace it. Dot fluid, basically, is one of its properties. It will over time ingest moisture in there and it can ingest air into that fluid, so it can have adverse effects on performance. However, back to your brakes. So there's a couple of things you can do. If it's a front brake, I would unscrew, well, flatten off your brake lever for starters, put the bleed bucket on there. I think there should be something on screen showing you what I mean there. Fill some fluid into that bleed bucket and then take the plunger out and do basically a lever bleed and tap your way from the caliper all the way up to the brake there as you're doing this, and you may well find you'll get a few air bubbles out. If it's still not happening, leave it overnight. And method two, of course, if this is your rear brake, there's loads more places, loads of kinks where air bubbles can hide and they just don't tend to show up when you're bleeding a bike. So this is quite common and quite fiddly. A good way of doing this, if you hang your bikes up vertically like I do, you could do it with the work stand as well. Hang your bike up vertically, put the brake lever again so it's horizontal with the ground, so obviously the fluid is not going to pour out, and leave the system open, same way as I just showed you with the front brake, and leave it overnight. Basically, you tap your way all the way through. You can't always do this with brakes that have got internally routed cables or hoses even in the frame, so it can make it a bit of a pain, and see what happens. Basically, actuate the lever, you know, sort of bleed, do a lever bleed, all that sort of stuff, and hopefully the air will find its way up to the lever and then pop out the top there. Give that a try and see if that helps. And last question this week is, what do you think are the worst conditions, wet and muddy or dry and sandy? Oh, for a bike, wet and muddy, absolutely no contest there. You've got to bear in mind, wet and muddy will translate to dry and gritty when it dries out, so you kind of get both at once there, so you're not just suffering the one. You've also got to bear in mind that water is one of those things, it chooses a path of least resistance. It will find its way into stuff on your bike that you didn't think possible, and with that, it will take that grit in there, then it dries out and you're left with that grittiness on the inside of your bike. Yes, admittedly, dry, sandy and gritty will certainly be bad on your drivetrain, but it's definitely easier to get off than a wet, gritty, mud, muck, ugh, all that stuff. All the stuff that we have to come in the coming months here in the UK, which secretly I do kind of like, but it just tires you out after a while. When you've had like 6 months of it, you're like, it gets a bit hard work when you're spending more time cleaning your bike than you are riding it. But there you go. And we're done for this week. Don't forget, get your comments in underneath there. You can direct questions directly to myself, to Anna, of course, to the EMBN crew. You've got Chris and Jones over there. And of course, to GMBN. More than happy to get them involved on a special show. So any requests you got, please get involved down there. And thank you, as always, for supporting the channel. See you later.